This is Ham Radio Now, episode 208. Wait, I'm not ready for the title yet. I got a little bit of business to do before we get into today's show. The first thing I need to tell you about is this, the Kickstarter for Ham Radio Now. It is going along. It is for shooting video of the Tapper Digital Communications Conference. Launched it a couple days ago. So I don't, this audience, the folks that are going to gather for this show, you might not be serious Tapper people. But just in case you are, the Kickstarter is running, and in 2 days we're over 10%, $10,000 goal. So woohoo, if you're interested in that sort of thing, hamradionow.tv, and you can find out all about it. Second, Arvin is back there. He wants me to do the pitch for just general funding of Ham Radio Now. So hamradionow.tv, and on his icon, you can make a contribution if you enjoy the program. We'll find out if you enjoy this program. Field Day. I'm wearing my Field Day t-shirt from 2003. It's over 10 years old. Makes me feel old. Undisputed fact. Field Day is the most popular event of the ham radio year. More hams involved in Field Day than any other single activity all year long. But what is it? Some people will say it is an emergency communications exercise, something for the EMCOMM folks. Some people don't. Some people say it is a contest. Some people don't. But we keep score, so maybe it is. Some people say it's just a social event, hams getting together. The hams that are not all that excited about it being a contest, but they still keep score. And yes, okay, so they're running generators and stuff, and maybe they're going to learn something about EMCOMM if they're forced to ever actually do any at some point. But for them, it's just getting together, drinking beer. Hang on. If I don't do this, I'm going to have some painful claws in my chin. Yeah, there you go, mouse. It's just an excuse to get together and drink beer and eat barbecue or whatever your favorite Field Day food is. And many people will tell you food is the most important part of Field Day. So just a social event. So we got those three things: EMCOMM exercise, contest, social event. Let me lay another undisputed fact on you. Field Day is the biggest media event of the ham radio year. Something you might not have recognized. More general news coverage on television, in newspapers, in radio. Really? Radio? Does anybody do news on radio anymore? I'm not so sure about social media. We'll find out about that. And so, this is Ham Radio Now, episode 208. What Field Day is really all about. And that is an official clickbait title. And what my guests who are about to appear here on Skype don't see is the graphic I'm adding afterwards, which says clickbait and has klaxons and stuff going. You guys didn't see that, but pretend that you saw it and respond to that. What Field Day is really all about, publicity. Yes or no? Oh, I guess I should introduce who the guests are. I'm not very good at this. On the right-hand side of my screen is Sean Kutzko, KX9X. Sean is the ARRL Media and Public Relations Manager.
Hello.
On the left is Katie Allen, WY7YL, one of the coolest call signs going. And Katie, I think I've got your title correct as the ARRL PR Chairman.
That's
Committee.
Correct.
PR Committee Chairman.
Yes.
So you're in charge of, I don't even know what, well, I know what the PR committee is, but these people out here don't know. So we'll find out in just a minute. And Sean, you have taken over a couple of years ago from Alan Pitts.
That's correct. Alan retired in 2013 and I took over in June. So been at it about 2 years now.
Okay. And Katie, what is this PR committee thing?
Well, it's a committee that's appointed by the president to serve at the leisure of the board of directors. But we really exist in order to provide support and guidance to the staff of the ARRL who are involved with media and public relations. We have a brand new committee this year. It's a little smaller than in the past, and we're really focusing on some big picture items this year, looking at how do we reach out beyond our own community and get more people interested and excited in amateur radio, and then embracing everyone and bringing them together. So it's been a really interesting year so far, and we're really excited about Field Day coming up, and sure do appreciate being on the show today.
I'm glad to have you guys. And am I right? Field Day is the, wait a minute, I'm still learning how to do this. There we go. Field Day is the biggest media event of the year in ham radio?
For general coverage, yes. Field Day receives more media coverage than any other time period during the year.
What else competes? I mean, emergency, if there's a hurricane.
Right, if there's a major disaster like a tornado, a hurricane, or a flood, that will get good coverage as well from a media standpoint. But in terms of general coverage, day-to-day coverage, Field Day far and away gets amateur radio on television and on the media more than any other event.
Yeah, and I think we can say all year long, at cumulative all year long. More
yes.
Field Day stuff, even though it's concentrated in just that, you know, one little period.
That's correct.
In the weekend of Field Day. More total coverage than anything else.
That is true. That it is always on Field Day weekend that you will see all sorts of reporters trying their hand at ham radio for the very first time.
Which is always fun.
And clumsily fumbling their way through a QSO. Fortunately, they have a good editing crew back at the TV station that can clean it up a little bit.
But, and you've got an example of something that we're going to play in a little bit that's just an awesome example of editing.
Yes.
We'll take a look at that in a couple of minutes. But the audience for this show, I'm not sure who they're going to be. But if you're in the media, you need to be conscious of who you are talking to and what that message is going to be. We're talking to an audience. They're, you know, mostly going to be hams. What is the message we want to craft today? What is it that we want to tell these guys?
The main message that I would like to convey to everybody watching this show is... As has already been expressed, Field Day is your number one opportunity to get the word out to your community about what amateur radio can do for your community, not only in times of disaster or emergency, but also on a regular basis, assisting with community events, providing a way for the general community to learn about science and electronics, educational opportunities that you may be able to have interfacing with your schools in your area. So it's not strictly an emergency communications message, although that's obviously a very large part of what we do. But Field Day publicity gives you the opportunity to show just how broad of a reach amateur radio can have in your community.
Okay. I am going to call you on something.
All right.
It's what I call the fire hose effect.
All right.
Whenever you get a ham trying to explain something about ham radio to the media, they point the fire hose at the reporter and give them everything all at once. So we're going to have to dial back a little bit.
Okay.
And get, you know, a little more point by point. Mm-hmm. Frankly, I don't know how to do that. I'm not really good at it myself. I just know it's something that we sort of have to do. Well, tell you what, let's get people excited about a little bit of Field Day publicity. And what I want to do is play this TV news story from KHQ in Spokane, Washington, and see what I think we're going to agree is a really good Field Day story.
What's so cool about today?
The ability to tinker. Hands on.
I'm going to put an antenna up.
It's not plug and play.
You get a rush, you can put it up to 90 pounds. I'm telling you, it'll soar.
It gives us an opportunity to practice remote setups. It is a carnival atmosphere sometimes.
Okay, going over here. Other slide.
You have to work at it.
A little bit better. How about that?
How's that? How's that?
I didn't say a word.
Come on, fella. Keep talking.
Good. All right. I'm going to tie off to a That's something.
CQ Field Day.
CQ Field Day.
CQ Field Day.
Say that again.
Field Day is a chance for amateur radio operators.
Echo Whiskey Alpha, over.
Around the world.
Why isn't he hearing me?
To get out in the field.
Victor Hotel Foxtrot.
And operate remotely.
I'm going to get one of these guys yet.
Using battery power.
Generator, solar power.
Gotta wait for him to finish talking.
And practice setting up for emergency communications.
CQ Field Day, CQ Field Day. This is Whiskey Romeo 7, Victor Hotel Foxtrot, CQ Field Day.
The idea is to work a 24-hour period. It's sort of a contest to see how many people you can contact.
Lima Echo Delta. This is Whiskey Romeo 7.
Victor Hotel Foxtrot, CQ Field Day. My mom said you could contact people from Minnesota or other states. I'm like, cool.
Copy, it's Kilo 5 Tango Radio Oscar. Thank you there, young lady, and good luck.
And good luck to you.
Tied mic so far.
But the primary reason is to prepare ourselves for emergency communication in disaster zones where AC mains are not available, cell phones, landline phones are out, and we pass information.
Whiskey Romeo 7, Victor Hotel Foxtrot on a balloon wire antenna, CQ Field Day.
We provide backup communication. We have a motto, when all else fails, amateur radio, we're there.
Please copy Whiskey Romeo 7, Victor Hotel Foxtrot.
All right. I'm going to go out on a limb and say that you are not going to get a story that good on your local TV station.
Probably not.
What made that so good? What made that great?
The editing was fantastic, but the other thing that I really liked about it was there was a lot of trial and error that was shown in the video. People setting up, not necessarily getting things right the first time. It lent the video lent itself to telling the story that Field Day is kind of an improvisational event, and you have to make it up as you go along. And no amount of planning in a disaster situation is going to cover every single scenario. So being able to improvise and make adjustments on the fly in the field like that is a major part of what Field Day is all about. And I think that that video captured that exceptionally well.
Katie, did you catch anything about it that got your attention really close?
Yeah, I agree. I agree with Sean. And, you know, I recognize a lot of my own field days in that video when you were trying to attach to someone or aren't they hearing me? And it makes me think, you know, we operate Field Day on top of a mountain at 6,900 feet elevation. And a couple of years ago, we had a field day that we got everything all set up, and then an 80-mile-an-hour winds came through with a horrendous storm, knocked everything back down. And so we had to start from scratch Saturday morning, and everyone was freaking out and thought, we'll never get it done. And it just reminded me of that, and I kept saying to everybody, I said, this is what Field Day is all about. I said, you know, we couldn't have asked for a better scenario because this is, you know, if this is really what the real world happens and we need to be able to practice putting everything back together. I really love that they also had a young person in the video. Certainly as a YL ham, I would have loved to see a woman out there operating, but the fact that it was at least some various ages was really good. And the trial and error that they went through is just what we all experience. In different areas of the country, all have to deal with different things. For us here in Wyoming, we deal with horrendous weather, fog, rain, near tornadoes, thunderstorms. And that's just what we deal with. And we know it happens every year. And every year we hope maybe it won't be this year, but it always does. And so I think the video tells a great story. And I mean, I laughed the whole way through. It was entertaining. And and that's what people are interested in watching. They're not going to want to be bored watching someone just calling CQ if they don't get it.
It was
so
fun.
It's fun and engaging. And that's what people are interested in.
And it made what we do look like fun.
We know it's fun.
We know it's fun, but it's getting the fun communicated to someone watching us can be difficult.
I think that the editing did a good job of communicating that fun because it was a lot of rapid fire shots of different events going on simultaneously. So I think that the editing lent itself to that.
Yeah, very fast pace. And Katie, I think if there had been a woman at that field day, probably, based on what I've seen from the professionalism that was put together, and the editing did a lot, but it started with the shooting. It started with the reporting.
Yes.
That they would have said, wait, there's one of these things is not like all the other ones. Let's go get a shot.
Well, although there was
a shot.
One of the QSOs that was filmed was with a YL operator somewhere.
Yeah.
So that was something.
Okay.
Right. And I think probably one of the things that made that also successful was the pre-work that was done to organize it. I mean, it probably wasn't just the editing after the fact, but it's whatever groundwork was laid ahead of time by whether it was a PIO in that area or someone who's very proactive with the club, that they were able to at least get some of the story told ahead of time. So at least when the reporters came out, they had an idea what to expect, which then lent itself to some really good editing.
Yeah, let's talk about how to do that in just a little bit. One of the things that I liked about it, and again, it's my antipathy toward the fire hose effect, is they didn't try to tell the entire story. They just they showed enough of what we do to make it look interesting. And if someone caught that interest, then they go find out more. Not here's everything that there is to do about it.
Right.
Our audience, I'm kind of trying to focus on who is watching us right now. Hams involved in field day, and we're going to get all the PIOs. We're going to get all the folks that are already experts in doing publicity. Not talking to you guys. I want to talk to the guys that are going to that two-guy field day, you know, the 1A, the 2A station, that have never considered getting publicity. Or if you have, you've been disappointed with what you've got. And let's help them figure out how to do a little bit better. This is going to be watched. Today is, today is June 9th. This should be online tomorrow on June 10th. Most of the people watching it are going to be watching by the 15th or so, and then the audience will trickle off. We got time. We still got time to do something. Well, before we tell them what to do, are we in the window of getting something done about getting publicity?
It's getting pretty close to the end at this point. Media outlets are going to be working to get their filler stories, as they would call it, solidified a few weeks in advance. So we're getting pretty close to the wire in terms of coverage for a non-major news event. But there's still plenty of time to get the word out about what your operation is going to be doing, where they're going to be set up, and we have a lot of tools that we can give you for free to help you get the word out about your field day operation. And we'll touch base on those, I'm sure, in just a little bit. But there is still plenty of time to get the word out.
Katie, are you in charge of publicity for your field day operation?
Yeah, of course I am. And
where do you stand in the process right now? What have you accomplished so far?
Well, I actually did miss the ball on one thing, and self-admittedly, I totally neglected to notify my county commissioners. We usually get a resolution ahead of time, but that's something I always recommend, that if you have a county or city council meeting between now and then, we have a template resolution that can be used. It makes a nice little PR piece that you can put at your station. I've already kind of put the bug in the ear of my local reporter who covers our county. And fortunately, she's a good friend of mine and basically usually puts in whatever I write. So I'll be sure to get an advanced story put out, as well as sending it off to Carl at our radio station. Of course, you know, I have the advantage of being in a very small, very small community. We have a county of only 7,000 people. But getting that put in place and then organizing, right now I'm just organizing paperwork to have some things ready. We're a little bit off the beaten track from where we are. So a lot of times we get basically ride by tourists that are heading off to another area to see all of our antennas and our signage and just wander up to see what's going on. And then I also do direct invites to my elected officials, our county commissioners, and all the folks that work for our communities. And usually I'll get a half dozen or so that'll come up, and it's getting to be an annual thing. So they like to come up and see what we're doing. And also because we do utilize county resources, we have, because I'm also the PIO for our county emergency management and fire departments, I have the ability.
So you're connected.
Yeah, so I get to, use our county emergency communications trailer and a tent. So this year we have a place to sleep, which is really kind of nice. But again, I'm in a small community. So, I pretty much have everybody on my cell phone and I just text them when I need something. But in a bigger city and community, the more you can make a personal outreach, that's always the biggest, it's always a little bit scary. But it's the best way to reach out to someone and just tell the story a little bit. And like Sean said, we'll get into a little bit more about what to actually say. But again, start off by keeping it simple. I really agree. The whole fire hose scenario can totally overwhelm people.
Yeah. You have given me a lot to chew on, and I don't remember most of it. So I'm going to grab one of the last things that you touched on, which is the size of your community. You're out in Wyoming.
Yes.
I mean, there's 50 people and 1,000 prairie dogs.
Yeah, or maybe more like 5,000 antelope, you know, a couple thousand prairie dogs and a few people and 8 million pickup trucks. Yep. So, yeah.
So, Sean, I have lived in Chicago. I have lived in a town of 20,000 people in Arizona. And now I live in we're about the 28th media market in Raleigh, mm-hmm. North Carolina area, a market of a little over 1 million people. That makes a difference. You're not going to get.
Sure does.
You're not going to get 4 network stations in New York City to cover field day for you, I don't think.
No, you're not. And I can relate to your travels. I've lived in a city as small as 4,000 people in the middle of East Central Illinois, and I'm now living in a large metro area that has around 2 million people in the greater Hartford area. So I've seen both extremes as well. Katie nailed it on the head. It's all about personal relationships. Making connections with the people, the reporters, the elected officials, and certainly in a larger community, you're going to be competing with other people who are trying to establish relationships with those folks just like you are. There are a lot of different approaches that you can use. Giving them a phone call is obviously a big plus, but if you have the ability to go to their office, meet them and shake their hand and take a couple of minutes and provide that pitch. Face-to-face contact is going to be better than any other approach that you can use. Making sure that you have connections established with the elected officials and the served agencies and the media outlets in your area before the field day event takes place or in the event of a disaster, having those relationships established before you reach out to them and ask them for something, in this case media coverage, is a critical component of getting a media story placed successfully. You have to have those relationships in place first.
Your government relationships are probably going to be mostly established through ARES, through the emergency communications aspect of things.
Mm-hmm.
Your media stuff, in terms of making relationships, we're definitely too late for that. If you're just going to get started now, forming close bonds with reporters, that's off the table.
That particular aspect right now, we're probably too late for a real close relationship. But you can make you can do the press releases that we have available in the ARRL Field Day packet. We have a pre-made press release that you can send out and just fill in the blanks and send that out to all of your media outlets. We have some social media strategies that we can talk about to reach out. And of course, there's the good old telephone. You know, that still works.
Yep, we show the website that you guys have for doing media stuff. So, you know, there's a lot of tools, go kits.
One thing, if I could, that's very field day centric is in every year ARRL publishes a field day packet with all of the rules for the event as well as ancillary information that you can use to make field day a much better experience for your club. And one of the if you click on the rules, entry forms, and information packets link, there's a link on the main field day page under all of the documentation for a field day PR packet that will give you 8 pages of information on every aspect of reaching out to elected officials, to the media, and to your community about what Field Day is about and what your effort can do to highlight amateur radio in your community.
Okay, so that looks like the place to start.
Mm-hmm.
One thing I was going to explain to people is my experience with doing publicity is 10 years old or more. I did PR for our local club throughout the 2000s, and I haven't done it for the past 5 or 6 years. Things have changed. The landscape out there has changed. You had mentioned social media, and we should get to as much of that as we can.
Mm-hmm.
But in terms of, once again, in terms of getting attention from the media, your market size is going to determine, to some extent, your success. Have you seen, is there a cap? Is there a limit to how big a market can be before field day is going to really catch their attention as, you would call it a filler story, and you know, maybe it is. It's certainly a human interest type story. It's
yes.
not it's not the breaking news story of the
right.
day. But in a small, very small market, it could very well be the breaking news story of the day. What size markets do we end up with that you think you can have some reasonable chance of success at?
I think you could have success at all levels. The smaller markets, the markets that that Katie is describing, you're going to get a lot of play on county level newspapers and websites that are focused on a community or a county. They're always going to be looking for stories. So that's if you live in a really small market, a small town like that, those are going to be your best resources: the online newspapers and the weekly publications, and your local AM radio station if you have one. For the medium-sized and the larger markets, it's really going to depend on what other events are going on in your area on that given weekend. Yes, Field Day is probably not going to be the major lead story for a large market, but you can certainly get, if you reach out and you do it right, you can certainly get an extra story, 45 seconds or a minute of a feature story on television. There's always opportunities for broadcast radio to do interviews and go on a talk show and talk about what you are doing. And then there's always the websites that you have access to in these larger communities where you can provide real-time updates of what is going on at your field day site. And you can use your social media outlets for that type of outreach as well. So you can provide in the larger markets, you have the ability, well, actually in the smaller markets too, you have the ability to provide real-time updates and draw people to your event as it is occurring. And that's one of the good things that you can use social media for. But in terms of the large markets, as much advanced planning as you can give a media outlet is going to work in your advantage.
Okay, so now we're planning for next year. some of those big markets. And as I was saying, with my experience being so old, it was pre-social media. So where's the bang for the buck? Where can you get the most audience attention? Is it still traditional media, television, newspapers, radio? Or how do you do this social media thing? I'm too old.
I think if you were to ask five different media experts what the best media to use, you'll get six different answers.
Right.
Each facet of media is going to reach to a different area of your community. Social media is definitely on the rise for people between the 20 and 40 age bracket, although there are some very interesting exceptions to that. There's a 2013 Pew Research study that shows that the largest growing audience for Facebook users now are adults over the age of 55. So seniors are the largest growing demographic for social media, at least Facebook, going on right now. And the reason why is because they want to keep in touch with their grandkids.
Yeah.
So
I've heard that kids don't do Facebook anymore once their parents discovered it.
That is true to an extent, but there's still plenty of activity that's going on Facebook. If you're really interested in the latest trends, you're going to be looking at other social media outlets such as Vine, which focuses on 6-second videos, which I guess that says something about the attention span for for some folks at this point. But there's plenty of opportunities available for you on social media. But what style of media is going to work best for your audience? There's no one answer to that question.
You know, I totally forget. I was going to Periscope this from my phone. It's not too late to start. Let me Periscope. There we go. Periscope. If you don't know what Periscope is, it is a live streaming, sort of a broadcast out to Twitter. That lets people watch what you're doing, and it's mostly for phones and stuff. And let's see. I'm going to start the broadcast. And unfortunately, every time I have attempted to switch cameras on my phone. It has crashed Periscope. So I'll hold my phone up toward the monitor for you guys. Well, the monitor that I'm broadcasting with. And this is what Periscope looks like. And I'm already getting people watching. I've got 5 people watching. And I just turned it on. And I have no idea who they are. You folks watching Periscope, this is a live recording of Ham Radio Now. And I am talking to Katie
Hello.
Allen. Yeah, Katie Allen over there on the left and Sean Kutzko on the right at the ARRL. And we are talking about media and ham radio. There are no hearts floating up my screen yet. So you guys want to send some hearts? There we go.
Oh, there we go.
this is working far better than I ever could have possibly anticipated.
You just can't plan this stuff.
we lost somebody. So, the question then is, how well do these things work? If you just send out some tweets or something like that, or put something up on Vine, are you going to reach your local people? Are you going to get anybody to come to your field day site? How tailored can you make this and how successful can you be?
You can refine your message as much as you care to. I would say that for something like Field Day, if you're attempting to reach out to your community at large, you probably want to cast a fairly large, fairly wide net. Facebook will allow you to create a page for your local ham radio club, your local Aries group, and from there you can start reaching out to other members of your community, your elected officials, your media representatives in your area, and you can friend them. And once you start friending people, at that point, there's a two-way information exchange that goes on. And this is the creation of virtual relationships. And with that exchange of information, you can start sending out messages about events that are going on in your area, things that your club or Aries group are involved with. And you can create events on your Facebook page and make a specific event for Field Day 2015. And at that point, you can invite members of your community, you can invite members in your network, and you can tell them the who, what, where, when, why, and how of your Field Day effort, and you can invite people to that specific event. Now, that strategy, coupled with reaching out to your local media and getting a reporter from your local newspaper or from the television station that you have access to, being on a local talk show ahead of the event, all of those things work in tandem. So that method of using multiple forms of media to get the message out about your specific event will work with each other, and that will help get the word out about what you are doing in your local area.
Okay, and I've got to apologize to the Got to apologize to the Periscope folks who are down to 2 right now, because what I realized is they can't hear you. They can hear me picked up by the microphone in the on the phone, but you guys are not on an open speaker, so that's pretty much all they've been getting. So I'm going to say goodbye to the Periscope folks and thank you very much for participating in the
Periscope.
I'm going to try to say goodbye. There we go. Stop broadcast. All right. So I should have said that they should watch Ham Radio Now, and in a couple of days or tomorrow, you know, maybe even late tonight, they'll be able to see what this was all about. Well, that was interesting. So it's as you're saying, it's putting a lot of things together. And at this point, the guy who is going to participate in the 2-way field day with 3 buddies is going, no. It's way beyond the effort I'm willing to put in. So what is that guy? What could he do? What should he do today or tomorrow? And what result might he expect from it?
Well, if it's just you and a couple of buddies, probably the best thing that I would suggest would be if you want to send out one of the prepackaged press releases that we have available in the ARRL PR kit for Field Day, you're more than welcome to do that and try to get that into your local paper. Other than that, you can go to our Field Day site, which is ARRL.org/Field Day, and there's a link on that Field Day page to download 11 by 17 event posters. We have a PDF of those posters free. You can download them. You can take them to your local Staples or some office supply shop and print up as many of those as you like. There's a blank area in the center of the poster for you to write your local information about where you will be, provide an email address or a phone number if you want people to call you and ask for more information. And then you can take those posters and you can put those up at your library, your local bookstores, your church, wherever there's a free bulletin board that you can put up in your community and let folks know that you're going to be on.
Katie, do you have anything you want to add to the how to do these things?
I would say for the smaller gathering of people, if you do want people to actually come by and check out what you're doing, you would also probably want to make sure that you're on the Field Day locator. And, you know, also, as Sean was saying, with Facebook, you know, Twitter and Facebook are obviously the two biggies out there. From what I've seen with Facebook, that's definitely, it's inhabited by a lot more hams, and I definitely agree where the demographic is changing. It actually represents our ham radio population of 55 and over. So someone shouldn't be scared if they're over 55 about getting involved with Facebook. But it'd be easy enough to just put out a note about that you're going to have this amateur radio activity. And really, one of the things that we've been talking about on the Public Relations Committee is really trying to help people use some more less ham vernacular and really talk about it as an open house, where it's an activity that we're demonstrating amateur radio in the field, real time, and invite them to come and check it out. And whatever way you know that you're going to reach your community best is a good way to do it. Again, it depends on where you are and where you're living in the world. But you could get it, you know, the posters out into places like your grocery stores and your libraries. Invite people up, have cookies, have, you know, have some coffee and food. Say, come have some free snacks and see what we're doing. Try to talk to a satellite. You know, there's so many different things that you could be doing. And it doesn't matter if you have a small operation or a big one. We've operated, the largest event we did was a 6 alpha. And all agreed we would never do that again. So we're back to a 2 alpha this year and keeping it a little bit more simple. But I'm still hoping that people will drive up the mountain and come see what we're doing.
You had mentioned the Field Day locator, and let me stick that up on the screen here. Yep. You are in the wilds of Wyoming.
Yep, I'm in the northeast corner there.
Yep, most likely most of the hams that are watching the program are very familiar with the Field Day locator, but some reason Google is not letting me
zoom in.
It's not letting me let go of the screen. And there we go. So there's your WY7FD.
That's correct. That's my husband's call sign. And of course,
so because Field Day
is his favorite, it's a national holiday as far as he's concerned. So that's his call sign.
Okay. So it was good to put Wyoming in the deal here, because it's close that off. It's not cluttered.
Right.
There's only a few stations.
No, if you were to go out to, say, Virginia, you'll see a completely different picture.
Yeah.
Right.
But this is great for letting folks in the media know where they can find Field Day stations, because the Field Day locator is all active stations that were, it's not left over from year to year.
That's correct. We clean that out every year.
So,
and last time I checked, there were about 1,060 Field Day stations that have voluntarily posted their location on the Field Day locator.
Yeah, and there's contact information. Mm-hmm. They indicate whether they've got a GOTA, get on the air station, which is really good for visitors. So any media that you want to point to, you know, they may discover that there's a different Field Day that they want to go to than yours, but that's fine.
Absolutely.
You know, it's
the main thing is that they want to go to a Field Day.
Yeah. that we're one big happy family.
Right.
One big warring happy family. the little guy, press release, phone calls, absolutely critical to mm-hmm. whether it's TV station, newspaper, radio station. No phone calls to Facebook. That's not going to work.
Yeah.
No. But there are all sorts of things that a smaller group can do. For example, ARRL has numerous publicity brochures that you can download free of charge. And I've done a One Bravo QRP field day before, where it was just me and a backpack full of QRP gear. But I always take a few brochures that explain what amateur radio is, how we function for public service, ways that you can find out more information about emergency communications. And I keep those flyers in my backpack. So if I have a visitor that just walks past me on whatever hiking trail I'm on and set up, and they ask, hey, what's that antenna for? I have something that I can give them. And all of those brochures are available through the ARRL online store. You can download them free of charge. If you want to order them in packs of 25, all you have to do is cover shipping. So we have that. Just having those brochures in your backpack, or if you're in a location where you have cell service or mobile service with your smartphone, you can take them right to the ARRL website and show them the field day page and explain to them what's going on.
Okay, a little bit earlier, Katie had mentioned the idea of not using a lot of jargon, and we can lead into some of the mistakes that we make. But I want to take a moment and play one more piece of media, and this is going to be my ego booster because this is a pre-field day studio interview that I did with the local cable news outfit a week or so before field day. And this is also 10 years old. So you're going to see, me looking a whole lot younger than I do now.
When a hurricane or an ice storm hits, it helps to have some help from the hams. That's ham radio operators. The Raleigh Amateur Radio Society takes part in Amateur Radio Field Day this weekend. And Gary Pierce from the Raleigh Amateur Radio Society joins us now with more details. Thanks for joining us.
Good to be here. Thanks.
We're going to talk about this weekend's event, but first let's talk a little bit about the typical equipment someone might deal with as a ham radio operator.
A lot of people think, if they think of ham radio at all, they remember basements full of equipment lining the walls. Ham radio has gotten very high tech. This is a typical ham radio transceiver that can talk around the world, 100 watt radio.
Wow, just that little device.
Yeah, and with the appropriate antenna connected, you can talk worldwide or across the country. I brought an appropriate antenna here. It's actually about 100 feet of wire, hangs up between trees, and we'll see a shot of how we get it up between the trees in a little bit with bow and arrow or slingshot. Everybody asks how we do that.
Okay, well, let's talk a little bit about what's happening this weekend and why it's important.
This weekend is something we call Field Day. It's literally taking ham radio out into a field, disconnecting from power, disconnecting from the phone lines, setting up radio transmitting and receiving stations that can communicate across the area or around the world if we need to practice for those times when there's been some sort of disaster, a hurricane, the tsunami disaster in Asia is the most recent one where hams rushed in and provided that first 24, 48, 72 hours worth of communications when everything else is knocked out. I mean, we have a tremendous communication system in the world today, cell phones, cable, internet, but natural disasters can still turn that off in the blink of an eye for a short period of time. And ham radio has always been there to rush in and provide that vital link that only we can do because we don't have to connect to anything else. A radio, a little wire antenna, a little power supply generator, and we're on the air and can communicate for emergency services.
This sounds like it's a fun activity, but as you were just pointing out, it's critical to have these services in place too if you do have this emergency.
95% of what we do is fun. Just talking on the radio to each other, experimenting with equipment, learning about the technology. And that 5% is the service that we provide to the community in emergencies and also routine service. The big charity events like the bike tours and walkathons that take place out in the country, we provide their logistics communications. And they say they wouldn't do it without us.
And how could someone get involved?
The best way for someone around here is to drop by our website, www.rars.org, from the Raleigh Amateur Radio Society. and lots of information, lots of contacts. They can find phone numbers and email, people to email. We do teach classes every year. So if somebody's interested in getting into ham radio, you have to learn a little bit of technology, some elementary electronics, some rules of safety, some rules of the FCC, and you can get a ham license. No Morse code anymore.
Okay. Gary Pierce with the Raleigh Amateur Radio Society. You'll be busy this weekend, but we thank you for joining us now.
We're going to have a great time, and thank you very much.
Snuck in that little no Morse code anymore. Mm-hmm. I think that helps these days. So I tried real hard not to do all the jargon. I got in a little bit here now and then. It's very hard for us hams to avoid being jargonizers, but I tried not to. Did you see anything that you didn't like in there? Go
ahead.
No,
I thought you did a pretty good job, actually. I liked that. You know, you emphasize that this is one of the major components of Field Day is that this is an emergency communications preparedness exercise, and that's great. You know, that's what people outside of the coverage that comes on Field Day weekend, that's how people learn about ham radio is during natural disasters. But I also like that you emphasize that 95% of what we do is fun. And I think that that's what needs to be brought in for a large portion of our potential audience is the fact that we're having fun doing this. And the emergency preparedness stuff is absolutely critical, but I think we can get bogged down with that sometimes. So showing people how we can communicate recreationally will bring in just as many people as when we emphasize what we can do during a disaster or an emergency. And I thought you handled that pretty well.
So what are some of the things, the landmines and booby traps we can step on when we're not? I mean, I've been doing this all my life, and you've been doing this all your life. And Katie, when did you start in any kind of media thing, or what's your background?
With ham radio is when I went to work for the ARRL in 2006 as a membership manager. And part of the job requirement was to get my license. And I was invited to go to W1AW for field day and operate as a go-to station. And along with an N1ND was my Elmer and my go-to coach. And I totally got bit by the bug. So really, it's just been, honestly, it's been my passion for ham radio that's brought me to where I am. I love talking about it. I love sharing what a fantastic hobby it is. The friends that you make, the contacts around the world. It's just purely about the passion and excitement of this hobby that I absolutely love. And I guess maybe that's what comes forward. And I think that's what's really important when you talk about what you're doing for Field Day and what it's all about is share your excitement. You don't have to worry about talking like you're talking to a reporter. Just have a conversation with them. Talk about what you're doing. Say, you know what, I get on this little radio here, just like in the video you just showed, it's perfect. You have something to demonstrate. We literally can throw a wire up in a tree. We've used a bow and arrow for ours a couple years ago. And when I get on the radio, I can talk all over the country and all over the world. Having a map there is great, especially if you have younger people come visit. It's a great geography lesson. And it's always wonderful when you see the kids light up. You know, if you can avoid using some of the terms like, you know, we're talking on HF or we're doing, you know, PSK to this guy, you know, it means nothing to other people. But what you can, you know, if you use something more generic and just be as you know, honestly, less hammy about it. and it is harder when you've been a ham for so long because it's, you know, really it's another language for us. It's part of our regular day language. We talk about, you know, I'm going to hop on HF and go, you know, go grab that DX later. Well, that means, you know, somebody's going to look at you and go, what? So you want to avoid giving those people the cross-eyed look from you. So you want to just try to keep it as simple as possible. Share your excitement, what you're doing, what the purpose is, and then let them come along for the ride. Let them give it a shot. You know, everyone always gets a little bit of mic fright, but if you do make a contact and then you have them sit down and give it a try, there's nothing more exciting than watching someone make that first contact and seeing, wow, I really just talked to somebody in, you know, in North Carolina, and I'm here in Texas. How cool is that? And then you tell them,
And I didn't need the internet to do it.
Too, you know?
Yeah, didn't need the internet. Speaking of jumping on HF, Katie, I think I need to, after we're done here, set up a sked with you on 20 to fill out my worked all states. I think, right, I think I still need Wyoming.
I'd be happy to help.
Yep. You know, Sean, can you avoid jargon? Have you mastered that?
Well, I started in FM broadcasting when I was 16 years old. So for me, that filter is on a little bit. But I've been involved with some form of shortwave or amateur radio since I was about five. So it's very ingrained, and I think that's Katie touched on it. You know, if it's that ingrained in your day-to-day existence, and the majority of the people that you interact with are also hams, it's easy to slide into that kind of jargon. The two that I find that I get tripped up on all the time are talking to other hams and saying that, oh, I just worked so and so, or I just had a QSO with such and such. Those two terms, I don't even think about it. That's just part of my subconscious vocabulary at this point. So if I'm interacting with a member of the media or a prospective amateur from the general public, you know, somebody who's just checking this out for the first time, I really have to make a conscious effort to not use those two terms. Nobody's going to know what 40 meters is. You know, nobody's going to know what VHF, UHF is. Very few people are going to understand what a packet is. So getting away from that kind of terminology and speaking more generically about you being able to communicate or talk with other people around the world and not using your smartphone or the internet to do it, you'll have much more success that way.
I guarantee there are two questions that you're going to encounter. You get into the interview situation, whether it's a pre-interview, radio show, something live on the field day site or whatever. Two questions you're going to get. What is ham radio? Katie, go.
Ham radio is, sure, you had to put me on the spot. Well, I would say for me, when I answer that, I say ham radio is a method of communication where you can utilize, you can do it from various different methods with a radio, an antenna, and a power source, and you can communicate around the world.
Okay. Yeah, you're right. I put you on the spot for that. And now Sean is prepared. And Sean, I'm sure you've right. you've got your elevator pitch fine-tuned. What is yours?
Ham radio is the art of communication using wireless technology. You can do it with various kinds of radios. You can connect an amateur radio transmitter with your smartphone, and you can send digital communications. You can send photos. You can communicate with satellites. You can communicate through the International Space Station. And all of this is done without the internet, without cell phone technology, completely independent of any other existing telecommunications infrastructure.
And sure, I'll do mine. ham radio is a two-way radio communications hobby and service. It's a hobby because we do this two-way radio thing because we have fun. We just enjoy it. It's a service because we're licensed by the FCC. We have to take an exam, and so we get an official FCC license, just like a broadcast station. But also because a major reason that we exist is to provide service to the community, either in times of emergencies or just for events where our unique communications capabilities can do things that nothing else can. So those are three different ways to describe what ham radio is all about. And you should have your elevator pitch fine-tuned so that when that question comes in, you know it. Second question, just about guarantee you're going to get this one. And Sean, I'll put you on the spot first. Why do they call it ham radio?
Oh, that's lost to the mysteries of time. The most common explanation is professional operators during the 1860s along the telegraph lines of the railroads did not appreciate new operators and their poor fists, so they called them hams. There are all sorts of reasons and legends and stories as to why we're called hams, but a lot of it is lost to the mysteries and mists of time.
Katie, we caught him in a jargon. He said fists.
Oh, that's a very good point. Yes.
Yes. Yeah. I say pretty much the same thing. If I'm going to introduce the concept of fist, if I've got time, I'll say you wrap your wrapped your hand around the Morse code key, and it kind of looked like a fist. And so your sending ability became known as, in the jargon of the telegraphers, as your fist. If you were a good Morse code sender, you had a good fist. Right. If you were not a good sender, if you were probably brand new, they would say you had a ham for a fist, ham-fisted, ham, and then we became hams. We took the, we adopted it as our own, and as you're right, it is lost. No one has come up with an article or a, you know, something from a magazine or anything that has explained it. Katie, do you subscribe to one of the other more esoteric explanations?
No, I generally say pretty much the same thing that Sean has said, that, you know, some years ago it was created because we are amateurs. We don't do this for a professional living, that it's that somewhere along the way that someone gave us that nickname and it's just stuck. And we actually take it as a point of pride. We don't find it to be a bad thing. We're happy to be hams, and that's what we are.
All right. So we are just about out of time. We don't really have a fixed time limit on Ham Radio Now, but we're going to get to about that hour point. Try to end toward aim toward wrapping things up. But the subject can go on and on. This is what I call one of those navel gazing episodes where I'm, you know, kind of looking at the media and the stuff that I've been involved in all my life, and then you guys have been involved in for a long, long time. But this gives us an excuse to go out to our ham community and say, we in the media have something that some skills that you can make use of to the value of ham radio. One last question has just occurred to me, and a pretty important one. Why do we want to bother with publicity? What's the point?
I would say that the point is to make sure that people know that we exist and that we can provide that service for them when they need it. You know, I would say that a large number of amateurs have started explaining ham radio to friends, family members, passers-by that they encounter in the park or along their travels somewhere, and they get a response back saying, oh, I didn't know that people still did that. And in fact, there are more hams now than at any other point in history. There are over 725,000 licensed amateurs. ARRL has over 166,000 members. It's never been as popular as it is now. So it's absolutely critical that we provide our services to our communities so that they know that we exist. And if the chips really, really fall hard, they know that we're there to help them out and we can provide the emergency communications that we need. And Field Day is the number one way that we can do that.
Katie, is there anything you want to add to that?
Sean said it so beautifully. I really can't make it any better.
Okay. There's a couple things that I think about. A very narrow and targeted audience, but we'll be watching the general media about ham radio. And that is the people that we are trying to reach right now with HR 1301, the legislators, the people in Congress, our local legislators, aldermen, county commissioners, whatever. All these people have some sort of power over ham radio. And primarily it involves what we can stick up in the air. The things that we need are antennas. And the more positive a view that they have of us, the better off we are for that. I always try to work in the idea that we need antennas. I almost never succeed. That gets edited out, either from a newspaper story or a TV story. But once in a while, they put it in. At the end of one of the stories I got on TV, the reporter actually said, and Gary said, that they do have trouble sometimes getting antennas up because of neighborhood restrictions and things. And he says, that's a shame. He says, mm-hmm. that's a shame. Mm-hmm. They weren't willing to own that statement themselves, but they at least attributed it to me, and I got it out there. So for whatever whatever that was worth. So,
congratulations on that level of success. I've encountered the same difficulty trying to get that message across myself.
Yeah, it's not one that they really want to get into very much, but they're happy to pat us on the heads and say, "Emergency communications, we love these people." Right. But as long as it can be done with an antenna no bigger than the one sticking out of this, which, you know, if you want to get an idea of the public's idea of antennas, this is a good example. We went from this to this, where you can't see the antenna, and that's because they don't want to. There's an antenna in there, but you can't see it, and they don't want to. On the news here last night, another neighborhood fighting a cell phone tower. I guess those people don't like to use their phones because they don't want that ugly tower sticking up there. Is there anything that is a burning issue for you guys that you just absolutely need to get into the show?
I would just like to say thank you to everybody who's going to get on the air this weekend, or not this weekend, but for Field Day weekend, and take the effort to get the message out about amateur radio and the role that we play in your local community. Thanks for doing that. You don't have to do that. We're happy to reward you with extra bonus points during Field Day for giving that message. So thanks for taking the time to do that.
Katie?
And just a reminder also that if you are going to have a setup where you invite the public to join you, be sure to have someone there who's readily available to greet your guests. Invite them over to the operating stations and, again, explain what's happening and as non-hammy language as possible. But it's really important that if any strangers show up that they don't get ignored. There's nothing worse than inviting someone to your party and then letting them sit in the corner and flounder. So be sure that if you don't have someone who's permanently designated as your greeter, that you at least have people that are willing to take turns, always keeping an eye out where someone might essentially enter your area. And then bring them around and show them what's going on so they can actually see it in action, and have some cookies and coffee out there. But make it as welcoming as possible. And hopefully it won't be right after you just spent 3 hours putting an antenna up and you're all sweaty and smelly. So, you know, try to keep one person relatively acceptable for public viewing.
But yeah, really, I've given up on that.
Don't ignore anybody who shows up that you don't know, because that person could be a new ham.
Yeah, when I've done Field Day and I've been the PIO, I'm the guy that they point the media to. But I've been setting up antennas and doing the go-to station and things like that. A quick story I want to relate: I have attempted to get our radio club to use 2 meters as an intercom to for coordination. We have one of those Field Day sites where all the stations are scattered across our 1,000-foot circle. We're not all concentrated in one spot. And so I've tried to get people to use their handy talkies, and inevitably and my station is way in one corner of a field someplace, away from the entrance. And so the TV truck shows up. And so what do I get? I get the guy running across the field, yelling and waving at me, "Gary, Gary, the TV station's here." why didn't you call me on 2 meters?
Yeah.
I didn't think of it. Don't have my handy talkie. So, yeah, all very good ideas. I wish we could spend many more. Yeah, Sean.
Something that I wanted to follow up on with Katie is if you've got a greeter going around and leading visitors through your Field Day site, take the next step. Have a sign-up sheet that people can can register with if they want to get more information about ham radio or about what your club is doing. Gather email addresses. Send them a thank you note. Take the next step. Keep them involved even after they visited your site.
Yep. So maybe we should have done this show a month or two ago.
next year, Gary.
I'll put it on my calendar for May.
Well, you know what? We were in a month or two ago. We were right in the middle of Dayton. So this is as soon as I could squeeze it into the Ham Radio Now schedule. And they're waiting for more stuff from Dayton. And in fact, I've got a whole Field Day show that I shot last year. I did a show in 2004. Called the, can I get this up here? There we go. The last big Field Day. I shot it in 2004. I didn't really get it on the air until 2011. I went up to those folks last year. the show is going to be called The Next Big Field Day. So I shot it last year. I still haven't put it together. You know, editing is a real pain in the butt.
Yes, it is.
Been doing it all my life, and I hate it. Field Day, the last rainy weekend in June. So
hope
to see you all there. Arvin would like you to, if you've enjoyed the program, and I don't see why you didn't enjoy this one, stop by hamradionow.tv and kick in something into the kitty or the piggy bank, as the case may be. And I will see you on the air at Field Day. Let's see. You guys get to identify yourselves and say goodbye. Katie, ladies first.
Why, thank you. 73, everyone, thanks so much from WY7YL in Sundance, Wyoming.
Sean?
73 from Sean KX9X at ARRL headquarters. Thanks, Gary.
And I am Gary Pierce for Ham Radio Now. 73, everybody, over and out. Okay, that was a good rehearsal.